Good morning, 10th class students. Again, welcome to our incredible biology class. Dear students, we are dealing with first chapter of our biology, that is life processes. And so far, we have completed nutrition, respiration, transportation. And we are left with excretion. So today, we will discuss about excretion. Okay. So every living organism produces some type of waste, either by metabolic activities or by other means. For example, animals accumulate ammonia, urea, uric acid, carbon dioxide, water, ions like sodium, potassium, either by metabolic activities or by other means like excess ingestion. And some of these substances are toxic, which need to be removed totally or partially from the body of an organism. So that is excretion. Excretion is the process of removal of harmful toxic substance from the body of an organism. Now, the excretion depends on the habitat of the organism and on the structure of the organism. For example, single cell organism like amoeba excrete their waste directly into the environment because they are made up of single cell and that cell is in direct contact with the environment. Now, the nature of the nitrogenous waste depends on the design of the body design of the organism and on the habitat of the organism. For example, the aquatic organism like bony fishes, aquatic amphibians, aquatic insects, they release their nitrogenous waste in the form of ammonia, and ammonia is readily soluble in water, so they excrete their waste in the form of ammonia, so they are known as ammonotelic. While mammals, many terrestrial amphibians and marine fishes mainly excrete urea, so they are known as ureotelic animals. The organism which excrete their nitrogenous waste in the form of uric acid are known as uricotelic animals. For example, reptile, birds, land snails and insects excrete nitrogenous waste as uric acid in the form of pellet or paste. Okay. So, in our body, different excretory organs are present. So, let's see lungs. As you already know, lungs help us to eliminate carbon dioxide. When we exhale, we release carbon dioxide. Skin, which contains sweat glands, help us to remove excess water and salt. Liver produces bile salt. Now the yellow color of our fecal matter and urine is due to the presence of bile. So bile is eliminated through our urine as well as our fecal matter. Now, kidneys, which are the part of our urinary system, help us to eliminate excess water, salt, urea, toxic substance, drugs. So, what are the various components of human urinary system? Human urinary system consists of a pair of kidneys, a pair of ureters, a urinary bladder and urethra. Kidneys and ureters both are present in pair form. They are two in number, while urinary bladder and urethra, they are only one. Okay, urinary bladder, a single urinary bladder and a single urethra. So this is the diagram of human urinary system. The parts which you have to label are kidneys, renal artery, renal vein, ureter, urinary bladder and urethra. This diagram you have to draw in your notebook and you have to label these parts. I am repeating: kidneys, renal artery, renal vein, ureter, urinary bladder and urethra. So, kidneys are reddish brown bean shaped structures located in abdomen, one on either side of the backbone. Kidneys contain millions of nephrons which will filter the blood. Now, the urine which is formed in the kidneys is carried out by the ureters, and ureter will pass the urine to the urinary bladder, which is a muscular organ which will temporarily stores the urine. Now, at the last, urethra is the opening through which urine comes out from our body. The tube which is shown with red color is the renal artery. Renal artery carries oxygenated blood with nitrogenous waste. Renal artery from our body will collect the nitrogenous waste and give it to both the kidneys. So renal artery carry oxygenated blood with nitrogenous waste. Nephron, which are present in kidneys, will filter the blood and pass that filtered blood along with carbon dioxide to the renal vein, a tube shown with blue color. So this renal vein will carry away the blood rich in carbon dioxide and it contains less amount of waste. The urine pass to the ureters. So what are the function of our kidneys or urinary system? They help in excretion, removal of nitrogenous waste, urea or other metabolic waste from our body. Kidneys help to maintain osmoregulation. Osmoregulation is the balance of water and salt in our body. The balance of ions and water in our blood is maintained by kidneys. Kidneys also help us to maintain pH of our blood. Now, the urinary system consists of two kidneys, two ureters, the urinary bladder and urethra. We have already discussed. Kidneys will filter the blood and urine is formed in the kidneys. Ureter will transport the urine from kidneys to the urinary bladder. Urinary bladder, which is a muscular structure, will temporarily store the urine, and urethra is the opening through which the urine comes out from our body. Okay, we have already discussed location of kidneys. They are located in abdomen cavity, one on either side of the backbone. Each kidney is 6 cm wide, 11 cm long, and their weight is about 150 gram. So kidneys contain millions of nephrons. So nephrons are the structural and functional unit of kidneys. Kidneys are made up of nephron, and the filtration which is taking place in kidneys is actually carried out by nephron. So nephron are structural and functional unit of kidneys. Adult human form about 1.5 liters of urine, and the filtrate which is carried out by nephron is about 180 liters of the fluid. Nephron consists of various parts. Number one, glomerulus, which is a group of blood capillaries. Glomerulus is a group of blood capillaries which consist of afferent and efferent arteriole. Bowman capsule, which is a double walled cup like structure. PCT, Bowman capsule open into proximal convoluted tubule. Proximal convoluted tubule leads to loop of Henle. Loop of Henle opens into DCT, that is distal convoluted tubule, which leads to the collecting duct. Now collecting duct will pass the urine to the ureters. So the nephron is divided into two parts, renal corpuscles and renal tubule. Bowman capsule and glomerulus consist of renal corpuscles, while PCT, loop of Henle, and DCT, they are the part of renal tubule. Now glomerulus, we have already discussed, is a group of thin walled capillaries. Glomerulus is a group or tuft of capillaries formed by the afferent arteriole. Afferent arteriole is a fine branch of renal artery. Okay, now blood from the glomerulus is carried away by an efferent arteriole. Okay, Bowman capsule is a double walled cup shaped structure. Bowman capsule leads into PCT. PCT opens into loop of Henle. Loop of Henle opens into DCT. So this is the diagram. You can see afferent, efferent arteriole. You can see glomerulus. You can see peritubule capillary network around the tubular part of the nephron. So in the urine formation, basically three steps are involved: filtration, reabsorption and secretion. The first step in urine formation is the filtration of blood, and this filtration of blood is carried out by the glomerulus, and it is also called glomerular filtration. Now this filtration carried out by glomerulus is ultrafiltration. Why it is known as ultrafiltration? Because the filtration slit or slit pores are so minute that they allow minute particles to pass through them. Only small size particles can pass, for example, glucose, amino acid, water, ions. Only these substances can pass. Protein cannot pass into the lumen of Bowman capsule because proteins are larger in size. Now the filtration which is carried out by glomerulus, it involves three layers. The first one is the endothelium of glomerulus. Second one is the basement membrane and third one is the Bowman's capsule epithelium cells. Okay, I repeat, basically there are three layers involved in the filtration. The first layer is the endothelium of glomerulus. Second layer is the basement membrane which is present between endothelium of glomerulus and epithelium of Bowman's capsule. Endothelium is the inner layer of glomerulus. Now from the endothelium, the blood passes to the basement membrane and from the basement membrane, the blood passes to the epithelium of Bowman capsule. So, this glomerulus involved in the filtration. So, filtration is carried out by glomerulus. Only small molecule can pass through. Proteins cannot pass because they are larger in size. So, small molecules like water, salt, glucose, urea, they can pass through these three layers. Second step is reabsorption. Bowman capsule opens into PCT, proximal convoluted tubule, and PCT is the area where maximum reabsorption takes place. Nearly all of the essential nutrients about glucose, amino acid, water, they are reabsorbed in the PCT. About 70 to 80% of electrolytes and waters, about 70 to 80% of electrolyte and water are reabsorbed by this pigment. Okay, about 70 to 80% of electrolyte and water are reabsorbed by this segment. Now, this PCT leads to loop of Henle. Reabsorption in this segment is minimum. Okay, in this area, only osmolarity will be maintained with the movement of electrolytes. Now, the filtrate passes to the DCT. In DCT, conditional reabsorption of sodium and water takes place in this area. DCT is also capable of reabsorption of bicarbonate. Selective secretion of hydrogen and potassium ion takes place in this segment. Okay. Now the filtrate passes to the collecting duct. In this collecting duct, osmolarity is maintained. This plays an important role in the maintenance of pH and ionic balance of the blood. In this segment also, selective secretion of hydrogen and potassium ion occurs. I am repeating again, filtration was carried out by glomerulus. Second step was reabsorption. Reabsorption occurs maximum in the PCT part in proximal convoluted tubule. About 70 to 80% of the useful materials are reabsorbed. The filtrate then passes to the loop of Henle in which reabsorption is minimum. Now, selective or conditional reabsorption takes place in the DCT and the collecting duct. Okay. Now the concentrated urine which is present in the collecting duct will pass to the ureters. Now ureter will pass the urine to the urinary bladder which will temporarily store the urine. When urinary bladders get filled with the urine, the walls of the urinary bladder will get stretched and the stretching of the urinary bladder will send a message, will send a signal to the central nervous system, and this central nervous system, our brain, create an urge in our body to pass the urine. Okay, and the urine is passed out through the urethra, and the process of release of urine is known as micturition. Okay, so these are the different parts of the nephron. So in glomerulus, filtration occurs. In PCT, reabsorption occurs. You can see in the diagram, reabsorb ion, water, nutrients, remove toxic and pH is maintained. In loop of Henle, sodium chloride ions will be filtered into the interstitial fluid. In DCT, selective secretion takes place. Secretion occurs in DCT. In glomerulus, filtration occurs. In PCT, reabsorption occurs. In DCT, secretion occurs. Okay. Now this collecting duct reabsorbs some amount of solute iron or water from the filtrate, and the concentrated urine will move to the ureter, which will pass the urine to the urinary bladder. So this is the composition of our urine. 96% of our urine contain water, 2% urea, and other 2% uric acid, chloride, sulfate, all these substances are present. Micturition is the process by which the urinary bladder, micturition is the process of release of urine. The process of release of urine. Whenever our urinary bladder gets filled with urine, the walls of urinary bladder get stretched and it will send a signal to our central nervous system. Now our central nervous system will create an urge in our body to pass the urine. Okay, and the release of that urine is known as micturition. Now, what is hemodialysis or artificial kidney? So, this is the important part. As we all know, kidneys are vital organ for survival. Now, several factors like infection, injury, restricted blood flow to kidney, okay, they may damage our kidneys. So, this leads to accumulation of poisonous waste in our body. Urea get accumulated in our body. And it can even lead to death. Accumulation of urea can lead to death. So, in case of kidney failure, an artificial kidney or a device is used. So, what is artificial kidney? What is dialysis? What is hemodialysis? An artificial kidney is a device to remove nitrogenous waste product from the blood through dialysis. Now, what is a dialysis? What is an artificial kidney? Artificial kidney or dialysis contain a number of tubes with a semi-permeable membrane which are suspended in a tank filled with dialysing fluid. And this dialysing fluid has same osmotic pressure and same osmotic concentration as our blood. Except this dialysis fluid does not contain any urea or any nitrogenous waste. Our blood only contains nitrogenous waste. There is no waste present in the dialysing fluid. Now, when from the renal artery the blood passes through this dialysis unit or this dialysing solution, the nitrogenous waste from our blood will move into the dialysing fluid. Now, the purified blood is pumped back into the patient through the renal vein. This is similar to the function of kidneys. Okay, so artificial kidney, hemodialysis or dialysis is a device to purify or to remove nitrogenous waste product from the blood. Artificial kidney is a device to remove nitrogenous waste product from the blood. Okay, so dialysis is performed in the case of kidney failure and it is done twice or thrice a week. Okay, so and at the last, here is a video of our urinary system.